Breaking news here at Dead TV. Evidently, there's been a train crash in Netherlands, so let's see if we can find any information on that briefly. Let me see. World. We might have to go to Twitter. Two people dead. Let's find a serious update, though. Let's go to RT or somebody. You might know. There's a GIF. It's flipped on its side. Let's see if we see anything else really quick. I gotta go to them. Naturally, I could choose anybody. It doesn't matter. Let's see what they say, though. Looks like a couple people dead. In Dolphin, casualties have been reported after a passenger train derailed after hitting a crane on a crossing in Netherlands. The incident took place near the town of Dolphin in the northeast of the country. RTL Netherlands has posted the first video, so let's check out the video. There you go. That was that. And somehow, let me see, you stream. There we are.
In de Randstad rijden de meeste milieuvriendelijke auto's. Dat blijkt uit het eerste grote onderzoek van RTL Nieuws Buurt Facts. We hebben nu uitgezocht welke auto in welke gemeente het meest voorkomt, maar we kunnen nog veel meer.
Buurt Facts is journalistieke informatie over jouw directe omgeving. Bijgraven door miljoenen gegevens heen en zorgen ervoor dat jij op internet of zelfs op je...
We don't need to know that. Anyway. Well, that's fucked up somebody's Tuesday. God. Anyways, you're watching Dead TV. We were listening to some music. We were listening to a documentary about the five ascending masters choosing... identifying the five ascended masters of the age. And every time there's a belief system amongst the Sufis, doesn't matter what religion. Notice they were saying like, oh yeah, this person was a Zoroastrian, this person was was both a Hindi and another religion, a Muslim. This person was a Muslim. But there's five ascended masters walking the planet, this spiritual thought system in India, among other places, the Sufis, Iran, Turkey, and everywhere on the planet now, where they're like, no, there's always five people in the world that just by their thought processes keep everything in check in a certain way. No matter how destructive things are, they're like in tune with all time. Like, they don't have to go any forward, and they're here by choice. They don't have to be like the Pope or anybody. They could be anybody. And all five of these ones that happen to converge at the time in India to identify the avatar of the age, which then that person's the next level above that, above the ascended master level, which is perfect already. So it's more perfect. So what Mayor Baba, he got hit in the head with that stone. And the other thing is all, I pointed this out on Twitter, all the ascended masters and these masters have one thing in common is some sort of head injury. And the theory that, as my understanding is, you have two spheres of thought in physical in your head, the left and the right, and there's a certain disconnect between those, and people sort of use either one of these reservoirs to varying degrees and have integration to various degrees. But when you have a head injury, that your brain forms new neurotransmitters and connectors, and we know that that's true, that a healthy brain is constantly creating these things to compensate as you go through life. And that's why it's important to keep reading and learning as you get older, because even as ones become frayed, the neuroreceptors and the transmitters sending out this information, you can create new connections to receive information. Even by as simple as walking and looking at the trees and just finding something to love about life. So anyways, in a head injury, that your brain compensates and you create all these new neural pathways that connect your left and right side to become a whole being. So, which is interesting, because there's all types of things. In your brain, you're not born with a fully developed brain, whereas other animals are. Because your head has to fit through the birthing canal, so that develops outside of the birth, and even the skull is collapsed. And you, for the first 5 years, it's so important that you interact with children in all these different ways, because their head, they're making all these new connections outside of the womb, whereas other animals are born to a various degree, they're on their own immediately with everything built in their DNA and their development after gestation, in whatever their birth is, they are on their own to a certain extent and are fully developed, and then in life with everything they need to know. Anyway, that's that. So he received a brain injury, and then a little bit later, what Baba did is he was like, at a certain point when he was young, he just said, okay, I'm not even gonna fucking talk anymore because you don't listen and I tell you anybody exactly what they need to know immediately. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna point out what I'm saying on a letter board. And he communicated through a letter board, and he never spoke again for the rest of his life till he was in his 60s. So like 40 years or whatever. And he would spell it out, and he would have people for illiterate people, his like disciples or his helpers would say, this is what he's saying right now, would read it for him if you couldn't read. But the thing is, he could look at you and understand immediately, like, whether you're paying attention or not, and stop. He could just look at your eyes and tell whether you were reading. So he wouldn't even waste his time, like, immediately. But he stopped talking, which is so cool. Because he's like, everything that you need to know has already been said. But there's a tons of books about shit that he wrote down and said. And one of them, he has this book called, like, You Only Live 800,576,000 Times or something. And it's like where he goes through this meditation, and he's like, these are all the paths of reincarnation, from a rock up to Godhead to where I'm at. So I'll just break it down to you in order. It's like a whole fucking book about every level of consciousness all the way up. And he used to give people advice. People, once he got popular around the world, you know, there's all these films of him going to England and movie stars in the 30s and all this shit, and people were flocking to him. And this really rich guy came to him and was like, dude, I would give you anything if you upgrade my spirituality. That's all I really need, is I need to know God. And he's like, Baba spells it out for him and goes, okay, here's what I want you to do. But he didn't, remember, he doesn't talk. He's spelling this out. But he's like, okay, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go to the bank. I want you to buy a wheelbarrow. I want you to take out all your money and put it in there. And I want you to roll down the street. And I want you, the guy had an alcohol factory or something like that. And he's like, I want you to go to your thing, your factory, and I want you to pour alcohol over yourself, and I want you to fire everybody, and I want you to just tip over all the bottles and give them away or do whatever, and I want you to go to the bank and check out all your money and fill up a wheelbarrow and just start throwing it around as you walk down the street, and I want you to go to a whorehouse and just fuck 300 women all at once, and I want you to leave your family. Don't give them anything. I want you to give away all your money. And the guy's like, what the fuck are you talking about? What kind of, like, charlatan are you to say something to somebody who comes to you asking to know God? And he's like, you said you wanted to know God. So I'm telling you, I want you to fire everybody at your factories, leave your family, cover yourself in alcohol, go to the bank, get all your money out, put it in a wheelbarrow, walk down the street, just throw it in the air as you walk by, and come back to me after you've done all that stuff. And the guy's like, fuck you, you're insane. But the idea was, he was like, he was just telling the guy who said he wanted to know God, he's like, he knew that the guy wasn't going to do anything to know God. So he's just like, no, you care about all this other shit. See, you're not even detached enough to even deserve all that shit, let alone to, like, know God and have that shit. So, because there's a hierarchy of your spirituality that you can actually have those things too. You can have some kind of balance in your life where your spirituality is right up here. And your family's right there, and what you do in life is, like, right here, and they're all intertwined somehow, to where your, like, work as play is there, and your it doesn't conflict. And then you've got, like, all the suffering of the world that's all around you that you see everywhere, and it's like you can't physically help everyone, and there's all these ways that you can help people, you know, like the old thing where they say, like, you know, you feed a man a fish, he eats for one day, you teach him a fish, he eats for his life, kind of thing. So there's ways you can get creative in many different ways in life to where you can help endlessly, and that could be on a rich level where you have some kind of foundation or trust for people. But on a real simple level, there's, like, so much need. You know, like, I have all these, like, spiritual metaphorical, like, opinions on a spiritual level. It's like, it's no wonder everybody's blind, because if you accurately see how disgusting everything is, you know, it your eyes would pop out, you know, and burn inside your skull. So everybody blocks the sort of truth out of how grim everything is. I mean, if you think that you're so badass or so generous or so handsome or so good looking and such a great person, you should go to a cancer ward at a children's hospital and sit there for a day and just, like, rap with some people in the waiting rooms or check out some kid dying for a little bit and think about who you are as a person without even volunteering. Just check it out, just to see who you are and where you really sit in consciousness. But back, going backwards of not being able to help everybody, and not being able, even if you dedicate your whole life, there would be such a deficit of need and suffering in the world that alone can drive you bananas. And there are people that are completely lauded as these great people until you really look into it, like Mother Teresa, when her hospital, you know, there was people dying of kidney infections that cost $15 to fix and antibiotics, and they would go, no, that kid's just going to die there. Because they would have to do that for everybody if they did it for the one kid. And it was endless. They did that shit nonstop. And on the surface, they're like, oh, this great person. And they're like, no, this is how we do it in India. We can't give these medicines to everybody, you know? So this person's just come here to die when it was totally unnecessary. You know, it's like, oh, we just give them some erythromycin and they'll go walking out of here. But anyway, we're not here to bag on Mother Teresa. But that's the truth. You can look it up. Anyway, about giving and being a person, the next level of that is you can actually just sort of do what occurs to you instead. And that can make you a great person too. That means you've got change in your pocket, and it's like you don't have to give it to everyone endlessly until you have no money. But when it occurs to you can help people in various different ways. And it doesn't have to be a big deal. And people like Maribaba said, oh yeah, if you give money to people, man, you do it so quick and so sly, like don't even let them see your face. Like when I do it on the street, I'll tap somebody on the arm, and as they turn around, I'll hand them money as I'm moving so quickly that they don't ever get a chance to see me. They look at the money. See, because I tap them, you know, and if they're speaking my language, I say, you drop this. Even if I'm handing a 5 quid note. And it could be anything. It's just like when I see somebody, it just occurs to me that they should have some of my money that might be their money. And then I don't worry about it. And then, like, with the contests that I hold, it's less about me raising 1,000 quid last week for giving away some records on Twitter, some Brian Jonestown Massacre. And before that, we gave away 50 vinyl albums. It was worth hundreds of quid or dollars. It's less about that, and it's more of a magnification that there are very few people that are doing this when everyone could be doing this. Everybody who thinks they're sponsored by Rolex or God knows who, these tennis stars get a Mercedes every fucking match they play. All these people could basically go on Twitter, these people with these crazy accounts, Taylor Swift, and just go, Gibson gives me a guitar or whatever. I'm gonna tell you what, I'm gonna give away this Gibson guitar instead. I'm gonna make Gibson look good today, and I'm gonna give away this Gibson acoustic guitar. All I want you to do is donate to either MSF or Oxfam and show me the receipt, any amount over $5, whatever. And my people are gonna write down your name, and we're gonna choose a number randomly, and that person gets the guitar. They would raise millions right there in 1 second. Taylor Swift would raise millions. Totally anonymously, never touch the money. Doesn't cost her nothing to have somebody keep track of the fucking people on Twitter. She could do it herself on a tour bus, go backwards. And she would raise millions in seconds. Now, amplify that by every famous person on Twitter, and they could be in any walk of life and just go, you know what? You just pick like fucking anybody you want. You pick any fucking person you choose. Robert Downey goes, hey, Macintosh, give me an iPad. Or fuck it. I made $55 billion or whatever it is. And he just goes, look, I'm giving away this iPad. Just donate £5 to the Red Cross or whatever I choose. And then we'll randomly pick this at the end of the week. He would just make like millions for those guys. So that's the point I'm trying to make. Is not even the 1,000 that I made for those guys without touching anything. It's like, look what we're dealing with. You know, we're not Mark Zuckerberg going, okay, well, I'm going to leave 50 billion to my baby, Shangshua or whatever, as a foundation for the future. It's like, it's a joke. It's all CIA fake imaginary money. The whole stock market is going to crash. It's going to be like, they're going to take all those digits of 50 billions. There's no way that money's going to be real. In the same way that if you go to the Weimar Republic, you would spend 50 billion 50 billion Deutschmarks going to shop for food for one trip to the supermarket. For dinner, you would spend 50 billion. And it wasn't always that way, but the value of money changes. Rent in New York was six. Some of those flats that are like $5,000 a month, those were $6 a month, you know, when my grandma was around. That's not that long time ago, right? They're like $6,000 or more a month for the same flat that was $6 a month. The value of money changes, and it's changing quick now. And I was explaining to somebody last night that the flat that I started BJM with, my rent was $250, but I think maybe the flat was $600, we'll say, for a three-bedroom, maybe, on lower Haight in San Francisco. Now that's $10,500 a month to rent. Think about that shit. What kind of student can live there? What kind of society does that? And that ain't even the fucking nice part of town. That's, you know, down the street from the projects. But what kind of society does that to its people to make it absolutely impossible for anybody to live there? They're like, okay, well, you guys can live like an hour's train ride away if you're going to work at that coffee that I really need, that latte or whatever it is I really need, because I work at fucking Facebook and I take a two-hour bus too. So, but I take a private bus from Google, the Google bus or whatever it is. Anyway, Jesus. People just don't know how to glow anymore, do they?
Glowworms show the path we have to tread. Dreamers, we should be asleep in bed. Moving slowly through the springtime air.
Yaşamam.
stars. The lizard knows how high they are. The stars are out of reach. The lizard lingers on a beach. The stars are out of. It's no good trying to place your hand where I can't see, because I understand that you're different from me. Yes, I can tell that you can't be what you pretend, and you're rocking backwards and you're rocking towards the red and yellow mane of a stallion horse. We'll be right back.
You know who that is. What a great guy. Speaking of great guys, we don't know if he's still great anymore. That's why we're going to check in with him. I'm going to switch to this and then go over here to Skype, hit that, and see if this works. Oh, he's hooked in. So I got that. Hold on. I'm making this work.
Make it work.
I'm going to work this right now. Let's see. Camera aspect ratio, no. Screencast shows current call. There's you. And now here's me. You're a little bit dark, but I guess that's okay. You're a dark and twisted guy. Lean into the screen for a second so people could see you. There you go. Well,
let me see if I turn this way. That's better, right?
Gregg Forman, boy, I haven't talked to you in a coon's age. Coon's life.
That's right.
You know, you're looking thin and healthy, though. Are you healthy? You're looking thin.
I've lost a bunch of weight, actually.
Through exercise or hard living?
Not hard living. no, just from eating. I guess from eating better.
What are you eating?
Well, just not a lot of carbs. But that's not interesting. That's...
My wife would find that interesting. Katie would go, good for you, Gregg. That's what she would say.
Yeah.
She would say that, right? She would say that, although she does enjoy a piece of whole grain toast with avocado mushed on top or a poached egg. She's partial to that in the morning.
Yeah, I don't do any bread.
Well, she enjoys that one bit because she doesn't like bread at all to begin with.
Oh, okay, well.
Except the kind you can go buy pants with. Just kidding. She's actually great. She's actually like a thrifty person. She's like, oh, I don't want to waste your money.
Right.
So weird, right? Coming from California and everybody is so different. Except your except your grandma, you know.
Okay. So what's new?
Everything's new. I got a new studio.
Yeah, I've been hearing about that, and I want to check it out. It's new location?
New location. Lots of awesome goodness. Who are you playing with these days?
Who am I playing with? I still play with Cat Power, but she had a baby, so she's...
Good for Shan.
Yeah.
How cool is that?
Really cool, and the baby's very cute.
Oh, cool. I was going to ask you if it looked like a lizard.
No.
Because you never know, man.
Like a little cute.
I've seen Rosemary's baby, and she travels in those circles, so.
No tennis root here. So she's been doing, like, some solo gigs, and I did a project, like, we were talking about... Like with Alan Vega from Suicide.
Yeah, yeah.
And the band White Hills, we did a project. And Nick Zinner.
We got to know Nick. Did you put that out, or are we still going to do it, try and do it?
I would love to do it. Okay. I mean, but you seemed really obviously busy. You know, you got a lot of shit going on, and you were setting up the studios. So I didn't want to bug you.
That's cool. I've got 10 records for people coming out right now. And Doodoo, who's like the biggest promoter in France. Like,
I know.
Doodoo hit up my manager, and we haven't been there since like Revelation came out or whatever. I put out a French album and 2 EPs since then or whatever. And then, it's like, he's like, well, are you guys, I don't know about Are you guys supporting a new record? As if it fucking matters in France. We sell everything in seconds. If you think about Eagles of Death Metal or anybody, we like, you don't even know how popular we are. Do you know what I mean? Even without being on, well, I want to say that we're not on normal TV. We're not on, do you know what I mean? Like, our corporation, which is me, isn't pushing us on the mainstream radio the way other people are. Do you know what I mean? I'm like caviar to those people because they love Iconoclasts and Revolutionaries and people that are outsiders like Surge or whoever. So I'm like one of those guys. So they just throw me in there, right? But if like Eagles and if Iggy has that new record with Jeff or whatever, then you know, then that's just in the commercial mainstream like everything else. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But then I go on TV and I'm playing for like 7 to 14 million people, see, in France, and it's just like, you know, it's just like whoever, right? It's just like anybody else on TV. It's like Cat Power if she comes and does the Canal 2 show.
Yeah, I do the same,
yeah, exactly. I do the same stuff as she does. But so we sell out it immediately the same places. What I'm saying is Iggy or anybody, right? Well, Iggy can play. We actually played with Iggy in Strasbourg, and he plays bigger places. He plays the 10,000 seaters, and we play like the 3,000 ones.
Was it Iggy solo or the Stooges?
It was the Stooges. It was us and the Stooges.
That's a good note. Well, I did record in the interim with James Williamson and the Stooges band.
You did?
Yeah, with different singers doing, you know, Iggy didn't want to do it, I guess, so... like Bobby Gillespie did a song, Alison Mozart did a song.
They asked me too. They asked me too.
I asked them to ask you, actually. And you didn't want to do it?
You know what I mean? I should have done it, right?
Yeah, I mean, James Williamson, to me, like, you know, raw power, search and destroy.
Rough power, even.
What's that?
Rough power, all the rejected demos.
Yeah, exactly. All that stuff that Bonk put out and then Kill City and, you know, all that stuff. Like,
speaking of Kill City, what are your thoughts on Kevin Jr.'s passing?
Horrible. I mean, like...
How close were you to Kevin?
Well, I mean, you know...
I know. I want everybody else to know.
He was an influence on me in more than just a musical way. He's like an older brother to me, you know, and...
A naughty older brother.
Yeah. I mean, and, you know, he turned me on to stuff like the Swell Maps and Nikki Sudden and Ekbit soundtracks. And but besides all that, you know, just a lovely guy. And I remember he was having heart trouble. You know, he got endocarditis from...
I know, and I tried to get him on the straight and narrow because, like, when I had my flat below Gregg's, when I had that... The house that Gregg built first for his own, for my godson, Tristan. But then that became my flat when Gregg married another lady and didn't want Tristan around. So I was living there. And then Kevin showed up in LA and I was like, dude, just lay on my fold out, you know, bed in the living room because it was a one bedroom flat, you know, and I said there's a jacuzzi bath with jets and all that stuff and let's just kick smack and I'll help you because I ain't gonna go backwards, you know.
Yeah,
like I'll just cook for you and just, you know what I mean, like we'll just I'll bail when you want me to bail and I'll be here when you want me to be here and we'll just listen to music and fucking moan whatever, right, you know. And it's a real nice place, but Gregg's new wife or whatever wasn't having any of it, so I got booted over that. But you know, and I was talking to Kevin's mom and stuff because especially in that situation it's sort of important to have somebody around if you got real heart troubles and you're kicking the smack. But at that period of time there was no way in hell that he was going to do it.
No, I mean, I think he ended up on Skid Row or something, and then anyway, he fast forward, he got a heart valve replacement, two of them. And then, you know, I don't know what he was doing, whether he was drinking or using or what.
Which you can't do. Let's remind everybody. If you get some P pig flap or anything in your body, your body's going to treat it as an alien invader, and you have to go on this medicine, and you can't add any more weird thing to your liver or anything else to suppress anything, because that'll just fuck you up. So you really got to be the straight and narrow if you get a second chance. And even after you get a second chance, you may not last that long. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, and then I remember he was just recovering, and you know, he was kind of, he had moved back to Ohio, and I sent him, you know, that TV show Mighty Boosh?
Yeah, of course.
I sent him, like, the box set, because he was so bored, just, like, laying around, and I just was like, all right, I'll just Amazon send this to you, and he really appreciated it, and then I would hear from him occasionally, and he did have, like, a new chamber strings band, but I don't think, you know, they did another single. I don't think he did very much after that, and then it was a surprise. I got to just say, it was a surprise.
It was a bummer.
And our friend Asa passed away. I don't know if you know him.
Yeah, Asa too. Huh?
Asa, very, yeah.
Asa was always a dick to me, but, you know.
Really?
He seems like he was... I know, but such an egomaniac. A lot of people always treated me like the guy to knock out to make a name for themselves instead of just doing their own thing. Because he was always playing with my friend John Henry, who I've lost track of in L.A.
Yeah, I don't know who that is, but I know
Jonathan
Sachs. Yeah,
like, Jonathan Sachs is his name.
I mean, I know a lot of, it's been a rough few months into the new year with people's deaths. Of people we know. There was a couple people, and then
David Bowie.
Yeah, well, that was the obvious big one. I was just kind of talking on like our friend level, but
lay another one on me.
Well, there was I'm trying to think who else was there was a girl that was kind of like a cool goth girl that used to live around here, but that moved back to Florida and she OD'd. I forget her name at the moment, but there was a lot of that, and it seemed to strike at one time, you know.
Yeah.
And in the interim, you know how it is, you got to just keep doing your thing and keep moving on and making music, and it looks like you guys are about to do like an incredibly
we haven't even announced Europe yet.
Right, I just see what Ricky posts, and it looks really, really great. And actually, I talked to him, because you guys are playing L.A. on a Sunday and a Monday.
Yeah.
And you're playing at this place called, the Terragram.
Yeah.
And there's a bar next door that I've DJed. I did a Gary Newman after party there, and where Gary came and hung out. And I was like, oh, we should do... you know, if you guys want, you could come over there and we could put records on and hang out. And he was like, yeah, that sounds okay. So, I mean, it's there if you guys want to do it, you know?
Yeah, we have to see how it goes. We play so long. Who knows even how long we'll play, but Jesus, we've been doing 3-hour sets now.
Really?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, because we can just drop songs on people's heads endlessly and it doesn't get boring because there's so many good songs. It's like, what the fuck is just happening to my mind? How can these guys just throw like fucking 40 songs right at us or whatever it is? And, you know, I can just change it up endlessly and go, let's play this one, let's play that one. And then...
Yeah, and there's, you guys have some new lineup people, like Ryan's in the band now, right?
Ryan's great.
It's like he's a great musician.
Yeah, it's like a real band now, believe it or not.
Yeah.
I mean, other people like different things, you know. It was always a kick watching me and Jeffy get crazy because he's so good at guitar. But he was such a human sickness. But and then having Dean, who was also a good guitar player, just hold it down. That was interesting, but it was such a fucking mess, a junky mess. But, you know, and back when... Also, when Matt was playing bass, and it was great, but then we never had great drums, see?
Yeah, well, I did that one record with Dan Allaire, a Pink Mountaintops record, and he's He's just one of my favorites, you know.
But then we got, so it's been a process of getting everybody to go. But, you know, I could never get Matt Hollywood to give a fucking flying fuck about stuff. And the bottom line is he's not a guitar player. He can play guitar. He can play guitar like me, but it's not even the same animal, see? Because I treat the universe as an instrument. So that's automatically going to make up for the fact that I don't know a fucking scale besides the one that I use on everything. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's going to make up for the fact that I didn't learn how to play by the Beatles song book and I don't know all of Led Zeppelin songs, you know?
Yeah.
I've never listened to them. If you treat the universe as your instrument, you're already a step ahead.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
So it just the consciousness is a totally different animal rather than like, okay, I'm going to write a song like the Jesus and Mary Chain or spiritualized or something. You know, it's like, come on. Just like
there's a lot of that shit going around. Or like people are trying to do very period-specific style
stuff. Even suicide, it's everything, you know?
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, I just... To me, I love suicide because they were outsiders even within the underground punk world. Like, they just weren't accepted. And the name suicide at the time was just like, they knew wherever pop music was going, it was going to go without them, you know?
Yeah, me too. And I love that about them is because we're on the same page.
Yeah. Because... Well, yeah, you that's definitely your thing. And, like, you know, it's kind of like... I heard this Oscar Wilde quote. I think it was Oscar Wilde. It said, like, you know, an artist should never adhere to the public. The public should always be more artistic. Like, basically, you make them come to you rather than you go to them.
Yeah, so. Exactly. But also, you know, you don't even need an ulterior motive if you... on a base level you really enjoy what you do, then
that's right,
it should be endless. You should not seek to dam up the stream. You should make sure that people don't throw shit into the stream, and then you just go down and grab a cup and it's endlessly flowing, and you don't worry about the water passing you by or somebody else having a drink. It's like, it's all cool, it's all just there. You don't need to like seek to even exploit it.
Yeah, I agree.
But we live on a strange planet in a strange time.
Well, it is. There's
some guy with like $30 billion who's trying to like charge the state of California millions for the right for people to walk to a beach where the law says you can't own the beach. It's like, fucking, how do you own the fucking beach? You fucking idiot. Like, I want to just go to his house with a whole bunch of whoever the Native American tribe that covers that area and burn it to the ground immediately. And my response to that, when I read that to Raw, it's a news aggregator, I was like, I hope there's a fucking earthquake and all of his property and him fall into the ocean first. You know? And fuck that. I don't care if there's more cliff property. It's quite beautiful. It's beautiful to look at the ocean, and it's beautiful to stand up on the top and gaze at the ocean. But fuck him, and fuck this whole mentality.
Agreed.
And I understand like how difficult it is for Dustin Hoffman to do cross-dressing with all of his neighbors on Malibu. But you know what? It's like, fuck off. You should build a fucking wall. Get the Israelis to build a fucking 40-meter-high wall like they have in Gaza around your fucking houses right there on the beach. And then... that'll keep all the fucking Palestinians and the riffraff out of your house. But fuck this whole concept that you own the universe and that you can pay to buy it because you're going to fucking have a rude awakening.
Yeah, I mean, right now, the universe is so...
tilted.
Yeah.
Slanted, I mean, like, and not enchanted.
I've never felt like it's been so out of order in my whole 43 years of being here. You know?
Yeah, today's show has been kind of about that in a way. I showed a documentary on the five ascended masters. Talking about Mayor Baba, who Mayor Baba just said, well, there are no more messages. You have them all. Now you got to figure it out. I'm not even talking. It's like, and so now that dude checked out when I was born, and now it's like you got to pick up the pieces. But it's also what I gather, you know, it's your life has to be a meditation to constantly, it swings naturally and you don't even have to think about it. But then occasionally when you do think about it, you go, wow, I need to get back to that place where I was, where I was feeling good last week or 1 month ago. How did that slip my mind that I'm not feeling fucking good about life or whatever it is? And it's that constant little adjustment of the pendulum.
Yeah, getting dragged back into the drama of this mortal coil, you know, always. And then kind of realizing you're in it and then kind of getting back to that place and then you get sucked back in and then you're in, you know, it's like a cycle.
It's the national psyche cycle. But I have a question for you.
Yeah.
What is your all-time favorite Cat Power song?
Well, that's a tough question. My all-time favorite Cat Power song, I guess would be, well, she does a cover of a Michael Hurley song that's not hers. It's called Werewolf that I really love. But one of her songs I guess I really like would be a song called Bully, which is kind of like a, you know, a really kind of like a dark.
Well, let's start with Werewolf.
Yeah, Werewolf's cool. Michael Hurley.
A Michael Hurley cover. And when did this come out? It's on the UR Capar record.
I think it came out in like the 90, you know, the 90s or something. I mean, early 2000s.
That's okay. I'm not afraid of the 90s. Anyway, Gregg plays with Cat Power. He's also my friend. I can't wait to be back to California to see him again. And you know what? You're a great guest, but also you're good for ratings. We got 50 people tuned in on the Central European time zone, and thousands will rewatch this when it's posted. So, and that'll just go on for eternity. But, you know, I've got all the gear set up in the studio now, and I've got more than enough for a band. And it's like, you know, you should email me if you know anybody who's passing through and I'm around, because I'm really keen to have people come in because I could just run it through the protocols. And it's just like, I have enough mics already set up. It's just like, oh, just play a song and go talk to this guy in Berlin, because, you know, 900,000 people will end up seeing this by next year, you know?
Yeah, well, I definitely think there's a bunch of bands. I would love to come through there. I have a little project with that actress Paz de la Huerta. Do you know who she is?
Yeah, she was like on my ass for quite a while and started sending me some really weird pictures. And I was like, because, you know, the Boardwalk Empire connection.
Oh, right.
So after a little bit, though, she was talking about, like, the Satanists in the business and all that stuff. Like, for instance, you know, I was already told by somebody else who's the head of the whole satanic coven in the Hollywood establishment. So we won't mention that right now.
Yeah. I actually just found some of those people, you know.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the big boss.
Oh, the big boss. Yeah, I don't know the big boss.
So anyways, we won't talk about it on this show. We'll save that for another show. We'll see if I can get them on the air. But I mean, the really big scary I eat human beings boss.
Right.
So anyways, she started laying some heaviness on me and I was just like, she's like, I want to talk to you in New York. And I was just like, oh. You know what I mean? I was like, oh. Because I know a lot of people that I always know naturally. It's like for a while I was in Iceland. And one time the head of the pagans, his house that's actually in Reykjavik on the bay is like an ancient pagan. It's like 1,000 years old with the stones. Like, it is the site. And one of my best friend's sisters was like, you know, they're looking for somebody to move into that house, and they just need somebody who's really creative. And I was like, and I was going to move to Iceland anyways, and I was like, should I go down and talk to the old man or not? And I was thinking, and I was like, No, it's cool. I don't mind having coffee and stuff and seeing them on the main street, but I don't know if I want to live in their house. And then so that there's like that, and then they're always like, "Hey, you know, it's Tuesday and we want you to join the lodge here, the Masonic lodge here. We want you to be part of our main lodge." And I'm like, "Let's go just take this Masonic acid instead and go spray paint the inside of this art studio and make a video." No, but I really want you to come inside the lodge. It's like, no, we'll just go down the street over here instead tonight. How's that? But anyways, now everybody dig this. Back with my guest. His name and I'm Anton Newcombe. This is Dead TV. This is both of us side by side, separated by continents and thousands of miles, almost a half an Earth apart. Like, if we drilled a hole, where does it Berlin? If I drill a hole from Berlin, it comes out in Wellington, New Zealand. That's true. True story.
I like those New Zealanders.
I like the Kiwis too.
Like a lot of them. They put some great music in the 70s and 80s.
Well, a lot of that stuff was from Dunedin, and it's still coming out. But they also have a lot of dickheads.
Is that right?
Well, it's everywhere. I call it FM culture. These crap clubs where all these kids go out to party. It's just so bad. It's so bad. How everybody's hooking up, getting laid on their little Tinder. They go to these clubs and then hook up right at the club from their little devices with really bad music or whatever. And I was just trying to get a kebab. I don't even drink. There was like a stand outside and I was just like, this is fucking hell. This is just like, I can't even believe I'm here. But just watching all the girls come up and the guys and stuff going, oh, God, do these people really fancy each other?
Yeah.
I felt so weird.
It always feels weird in that world. I mean, you know, we've crossed two different lifetimes. The one pre-millennial and the one that we're in now, and they're very different worlds.
Well, everybody was like, you know, talking about the dawning of the age of Aquarius, and boy, they got that wrong, didn't they? The fucking man to squash that like a bug. Can you imagine an age of enlightenment actually being fucking sitting on your couch watching virtual reality that's all mind control controlled. If you think they didn't control fucking MTV, you don't think they're going to control the content on Facebook Oculus. That's why Facebook bought it. And the thing about that is, I mean, think about what you can do on Facebook. It's not that great. Think about what actually exists on Facebook. It ain't that fucking great.
No.
It's not that fucking mind expanding. So I would be there. Trust me.
Yeah. Yeah, you made an exodus when? Like 4 years ago?
I was never
ago.
On there because they had too many pretenders and they wouldn't let me be me. So I actually had a laptop named Anton Fjordson, so I signed up as that, and then their supercomputer fucking said, no, there is no such person as Anton Fjordson on Earth. See, because it's an NSA plot. They use a super virus that goes into everybody's computer from everybody's computer. So it's everybody's connected, and they put a face in the book through you. So when they figured that one out, they're like, well, we know exactly who you are.
Yeah.
So I'm like, well, you guys won't let me be myself because you have 19 people, including one person, Francois Sky, who's pretending to be me in a profile and even dresses like me. The fucking idiot. I can't believe that people actually fucking hang out with that fucking lunatic. That guy needs to have his back broken. He needs to be institutionalized. Anyway, that'll happen soon enough. Because he's a fucking psycho. Anyways, let's get on to other things. Today's not about that. Did you think that Sarah Beth sounded too much like Cat Power? Because some people do.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
I didn't at all. I didn't hear that at all. I think she has her own sound.
Yeah. She bends things in this her own catatonic way.
Is that her on guitar too?
I think Luther's playing the electric bits.
Is it Luther from not Luther from like Luther Dickinson?
Luther from all those bands in LA from ever. He's got a beard now, but he's like in the scene. That's her man, Luther.
Oh, cool.
But he's always like a right-hand man for everybody.
Yeah. Yeah, LA's a strange place right now, too. There's like a bit of chaos going on here that's not really something I'm interested in, but it's got some people all up in a little bit of a tizzy.
What would that be?
It's kind of like this. Okay, so you know how sometimes like big kind of fashion corporations swoop in and they try and like co-opt culture?
Sure.
Well, that sort of happened here. Like Yves Saint Laurent came in and like started like courting these kind of burger slash you know, other local bands, you know, like people we know, like the A La La's and other bands, like whatever, and they played this big show.
Well, of course, but you know, like A La La's is just BGM light.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
There's no. Where the fuck did they get the idea to have a tambourine player?
You know what? I listened to it for a minute.
I heard it for 1 second on the mainstream radio in Berlin, and I was like, I was like, yeah, fucking where'd they get that idea from before they were born? Anyway, let's not bag on them.
Yeah. So, there's people in town that, like, this young girl who actually...
Let me tell you about Burger. Okay, Burger got distribution through Sony Red. And Thor's moved. That's his company. It used to be Red Distribution in North Carolina. We used to deal with them. And Thor's a cool guy. He moved to Berlin. I wonder why he chose Berlin.
Yeah, exactly.
So they're because they're going to start breaking bands in Europe. They're going to try to do good. But yeah, there's a whole thing going on. There's a whole thing going on, and I don't even try and do that here very much. But he's like, sort of in now with my mate Ollie, which is fine. I don't care, and I like the Burger guys, and you know I put out a cassette with them. They did a really good job. You go ahead.
No, I love those guys too. They're really nice guys. I think they're very smart too, but I think this younger girl wrote an article basically blasting Burger and all the bands for basically just
selling out immediately.
Selling out, and I think the story is that they each got paid $3,000 to, but their likenesses can be used for indefinitely, for eternity,
yeah,
by Yves Saint Laurent or something, and which is whatever. So a lot of the kids just wanted to go and have a good time and get free drinks and play a show or whatever. But I had a ticket. For some reason, they must have sent an invite to anyone in town that they thought might be cool at a party, and it's just not my thing, so I immediately gave mine away. Actually, Lydia Lunch was in town then, and I was doing a project with her, but that's a whole different thing. And basically, now this girl wrote this article blasting them, and then they fired back, and everyone's like, and this whole, like, you know, the whole age old, like, sell out or stay true kind of thing, you know, and I'm just glad I'm not part of any specific scene. I just, you know, I don't have time for that.
I really like Ty Siegel, though. He's a nice guy.
Yeah, I don't really know him, but I know Emmett, who plays in his band, The Muggers.
Yeah, well, he has a lot of bands, but I went swimming with him in Switzerland.
Oh, yeah? How was that?
It was great. He's a good swimmer, too. Of course, we're both from Orange County, so it stands to reason.
Of course.
We were out in Lake Lamoc swimming together. But he's a nice guy.
Yeah, I mean, those people are cool. It's not even about that. It's like,
I just wish that I could give everybody an education about contracts, because you could say, sure, I'll put out a record with you, but, you know, we do one thing at a time. You know? It's like, cool, you can take my picture at a party. I don't fucking care.
Yeah.
Pay me $3,000 for tonight. But all these people, like, you know, Rihanna got number one. She went platinum. In America, she sold 400 copies of her fucking record. And it was just because Jay-Z leaked it on Tidal a week early. Oops, we accidentally made a mistake. And everybody said, I got to hear this 1 week early. And they clicked the button, and that all counted as a sale. See?
Real?
Even though no money changed hands, because a YouTube version's click counts as a sale. So they're like, 500 million people just clicked on Rihanna. That's the number one record. And meanwhile, all the money came from Samsung because there was a commercial attached. So she got paid a couple million for the Samsung 7. But she only sold 400 copies of the record. And I sold more than 400 copies of my last record that week. I didn't get number one. I sold more than her. I didn't get number one.
But that hasn't really, I don't think any of the number one, the charts and any of that have meant anything maybe since the 60s or something.
It means,
you know,
something to me. We went down to go play in New Zealand and we got number 32 on the national charts just because we were playing shows and had a new song on the radio.
Yeah.
We were number 32 in the pop charts up against Britney and everybody or whoever the fuck it was, Taylor Swift that week or whatever.
Yeah.
Just up there with everybody else. That felt good. That doesn't happen every day.
So you guys are coming down to play this levitation thing again, huh?
Yeah, we're back. Thank God we don't have to headline anymore.
Yeah, well, now it's like, it's gotten, you know, good for them, but it's gotten like, it turned into like a real, like, regular kind of rock festival and stuff.
Well, it's good. It can only be so regular on Carson Ranch. I mean, you're still pinned in there in between a human waste rendering and a manure mixing fucking dust cloud. So you can only be so regular under those circumstances. But it's kind of cool. No,
yeah,
it's going to get fucking mega cool.
People.
It's mega cool.
I want to, I'm trying to get, I don't have a band that's playing there this year, but I'm trying to get, to DJ the thing, you know, and then do some of the after party and before parties and all that stuff.
Everybody in the chat room is going batshit crazy about Ty Siegel. Chat room, what's your favorite Ty Siegel tune that you want to hear?
You talking to me?
I'm talking to the chat room now.
Oh, the chat room.
Are you pulling the Robert De Niro? Are you talking to me? Are you talking to me? Are you talking to me?
I don't see anyone else here.
But are you talking to me? You're talking to me.
I don't have a favorite Ty Siegel song, but I love the Swell Maps.
They're not related in any
shape. I know.
But we're waiting for the chat room to catch up. I'm looking.
Okay.
And then then they're going to tell me any second what Ty Siegel song they want to hear. Because I normally don't take requests. It's not that kind of show.
Uh-oh, it's catching up, I think.
Yeah, it is, but they're like retarded about it. We're asking them a question.
Yeah. Something from Fuzz.
That doesn't cut it, man. You need to make a decision.
Yeah.
Something from Fuzz. How about something from Use Your Fuzzy Brain and pick something?
It doesn't look like we're going to get a lot of help in this department. All right, somebody put one in there.
What do you think? What did they say?
One person said Candy Sam. Somebody else said Manipulator.
Okay, the first person gets it.
Candy Sam.
We'll see, okay?
Yeah. Otherwise, though, later maybe you can play the 30 blocks.
Hold on. Single file, no cuts. Are you fucking... all you belligerent monkeys puking up chunks of demands are making me sick. I'm a man. If I wanted to take orders, I'd join the Marines.
Green eyes have not yet been known to me, for I have not your eyes. My rating is not yet been known at all. Oh, this endless day, big and grey on the second floor. My friend died last night, or tried. That's not bad for such a small place. He's posing like he's quite big-headed. I know you're a heart for mine. The shades are the Venetian kind. They are drawn down blind. Four only lines are shattered in angles on my wall in the daytime. My tales have not yet been seen by them. They are only paper. Screaming ladies, converted shirts. I wish and wish it never came true. Have not yet been known to me, for I have not your eyes. My waiting is not yet been known at all. Oh, this endless day, big and grey on the second floor. My friend died last night, or tried. Lights are not bad for such a small place. He's posing like he's quite big-headed. I know you're a heart for mine. The shades are the Venetian kind. They are drawn down blind. Four only lines are shattered in angles on my wall in the daytime. My tales have not yet been seen by them. They are only paper. Screaming ladies, converted shirts. I wish and wishes that ever came true. Green eyes have not yet been known to me, for I have not your eyes.
Okay, we're back. We're back. That ends abruptly. God, I love her voice so much. It's just like la 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 la.
Yeah.
I was just talking about that. Great band. That fucking Thorazine voice is just so deadpan and beautiful. To me. Behind the scenes, I was saying to Gregg, whenever I play something by somebody new that people think is hot shit, I like to play something that's old, that's hot shit. Put it in perspective, because people, obviously, they don't always have that perspective. Which we all learned together on this show.
Yeah. I really love that band, the 39 Clocks. You know, they're German.
Yeah, yeah.
And they kind of combine Suicide and the Velvets. They're old school, very old.
Yeah, I love them too. I played them. I played them yesterday, I think.
Oh, cool.
Because I like that. Charlie Parker's getting sunglass hipsters fill the room, crawling out of sewers.
Right. Charlie Parker's getting something.
Over broken sunglasses. Charlie Parker's getting hit.
Yeah, exactly.
They're beating him up because he stepped on somebody's sunglasses. They needed those to be cool.
Yeah, well, back then. Well, they were, you know, they were just like looking at Suicide and the Velvets and seeing how they dressed and what they did and all that.
Then I have a side conversation going on with one of my friends from the Velt. Did you ever know of those guys?
They were kind of like a shoegazy goth band, right?
Well, we don't know what to define them, but basically,
yeah, I just remember that they were,
yeah, What do you remember?
I remember they were like coming up, and maybe I'm wrong, but would it have been like the late 90s, early 2000s?
It was in the 90s.
I remember them, and I remember like thinking, I should probably listen to this, and maybe I did, but I don't remember exactly.
They were coming up various times. They were bouncing around.
Yeah.
But the problem was that the labels didn't know what to do with them. Do you know why?
Right. I have an idea.
What's your idea?
Didn't they have a mixed racial band?
Yes, they did, in fact. But why would that be a problem?
Well, you know, at the time, maybe not, but I think their sound didn't fit into a box. Then they have like a mixed band. Then, you know, and it's like,
So you're saying basically the band had too much Africa and the record company didn't have enough Africa in them.
Probably. I think that,
that's
you know,
interesting. That's what Brian Eno might say.
Yeah, exactly. Well, if Brian Eno might say it, then yes. what would you think?
They sent me a link to this Guardian article, and the first thing out of the first paragraph to talk about the record companies having a problem pigeonholing black artists with their expectations of what black music should be.
Yeah, and like
so fucked up, right?
Like you can't have for some reason, if you're doing soul or R&B or hip hop, it makes sense. But if you're a black artist doing rock and roll or underground music, like, you know, they don't know what to do with it. Bizarre. Never made sense to me, but.
Well, the first thing that I would do is blow people's minds.
Yeah.
With it. But it just shows you in a generation, even in one generation, do you know, like, I guess the Monkees audience didn't know what to do with Jimi Hendrix expressing himself.
Yeah, but see, I guess he sort of like blew the roof off everything and changed the rules for that moment. And Sly Stone.
But evidently Chas Chandler and Brian Jones did that.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. Chas brought it to Brian. And they were in the process with Alan Klein of making their own label, and Brian said, "We got to put this out."
Yeah.
And Mick Jagger said, "Fuck you. There's no way we're going to have some black dude on our label who's better than the Rolling Stones. You're fucking crazy." So then Brian was like, "I can't believe that you're not going to let me do this." So he started calling up checks. He's like, "With my own money." So he started calling up checks and started, he said, "Fine, I'm going to completely rebuild Cotsworth Farm. That's where your money's going to go then. I'm going to make my house bitchin'." So that kicked off the whole war within the thing, because he started drawing as much money as he could out of the thing when they were going to take the collective pot and make this Rolling Stones record thing. And he was only able to get the Jojuka track or whatever to have happen. But
yeah,
he was totally into Hendrix. Chas Chandler took him around. But anyways, that's neither here nor there. So anyways, these guys are back on the scene. I'm going to try and get them on the show.
That would be really cool. I mean, I always always wanted to check them out. But, you know, like I was in the middle of this other, like primal education of like everything from field blues to Stax to Suicide at the time. So
yeah. Well, I I'm just such a big fan of anything that makes people uncomfortable anyways. So
yeah.
Just the thought of somebody standing in an audience, loving some music, but shaking their head because they're like, how is that sound coming out of these two dudes? Even if they're 55 or whatever now, they're not. But you know what I mean? If they were like 55 now and blowing minds, I'd be like, that's right. These two dudes right here are fucking better than you'll ever be or whatever it is, right? So,
yeah, absolutely.
So I'm into that. So I'm happy. But then again, when I heard that Joe Foster mixed one of their songs, I was less than pleased about that because I hate that guy.
Oh, really? I don't know him. I just know
Forget about it.
Dan Tracy.
Yeah, well, Dan, whatever, you know. I love all of the young children on crack. But anyways, whatever.
I just love that first TV personalities record a lot. You, poor Diary of a Young Man.
My issue wasn't what Joe's done or who he used to be. It's what he is and what he does now. That's my issue.
Okay, I'm not aware of any of that.
Well, I'll be happy to fucking send you an email.
Man, people are still talking about the OCs in the chat room.
Yeah. Somebody asked me if I know those guys and like those guys. They're friends. But, you know, this really isn't always a platform for me to plug what's going on in the world. This is more of a platform to go for what's going on in my head to get me ready for these mixes I have to do with Alex. You know, then another part of the show will be me, Alex, and his brother mixing songs for hours on Pro Tools, probably, I guess, you know, until it's time for Alex to go play live at the 8mm tonight.
Wait, who is the band that you're mixing?
Alex Lipinski, but the record's going to be called Alex. He's like, he plays, it's him and his guitar and his voice and sometimes his brother.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's real pure. Yeah, I believe it. I mean, if you're doing it. How did that, didn't you do something with Soko?
Yeah, Soko, I hit her up on Twitter and said, you know, hi, my name's Anton. I have a band and I produce people and I have a label and I'd really like it if I could get you to sing a song in French.
Right.
And she said, well, I've never sang in French before. And I said, oh, fuck you. You have to do this for your country. She said, I know who you are. I love your music. I said, you have to do this for your culture. She said, well, I'm busy in LA about to start another movie. I said, I have a studio in LA too. I'll just send you the words in this recording and all this stuff, and you just go in and sing it and just nail it like Francois Hardy or something. And she just did it. She said it's too low, but she said, oh my God, it's too low, it's not my key. I said, you could do it anyways. I said, okay, I'll re-record the whole song in your key. Anything for you, babes. And she just nailed it.
Yeah, I did I played on a few songs.
I did a whole French imaginary soundtrack, and then NME tried to nail me saying, oh, Anton thinks he's so cool. He thinks he's so cool. Look at, he's doing this French imaginary soundtrack for this French new wave, and they tried to say that and you know, alienated his fans, and I went, huh. And then the movie that won the movie that won Cannes last year, the director was like, no, I want some of Anton's music in it. So it stopped being imaginary, the album, and became when people buy this film, then it's going to have some of my imaginary French soundtrack in the son of one of the French new wave cinemas movie that won fucking Cannes. A Palme d'Or.
Yeah.
So that's what they knew. See, I knew that if I just visualized it, that it would happen.
Yeah, of course. Visualization is like an under tap.
But it makes you a fucking threat if you can really do that. Like with all your shit, it's like this mystical power that you hold over other people in a different way. It's not like, oh yeah, I have all this money and my dad said I could be Prime Minister of England, you know, and then you're like, well, I'm going to make a phone call and get this army to invade or something. I'm going to make another call to this bank and crash an economy. This is more like a visualization process it's like almost like conjuring. This becomes beyond magic. It becomes supernatural. It becomes nature to a higher degree, not something that is out of a magic book. It's something that you found out of every book, including the books that you chose not to read because there was nothing in them for you.
Yeah, I mean, I've been into that law of attraction kind of like for many years at this point. I just don't, I should use it more than, you know, it's like anything, like meditation or anything. They don't help you if you don't use them, you know? And I always use, I wait to the last minute and go, oh yeah, that's the thing to use, you know? Like visualization or meditation, or, you know, now I have a meeting, like a group here every week that's a meditation group. We all sit around and meditate.
Related to the program or no?
Well, you know, I can't confirm or deny on air, you know.
Why the fuck not? Is it somewhat related to your process of well-being?
Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
Well, I mean, you can only help people by saying something.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, you know, for me personally, yeah, you know, it helps me. I can't speak for anyone else, but, like, you know, I used to be someone that had various, you know, addictive things going on in my life that I don't have anymore.
Yeah, and they weren't working.
Yeah, and now things like meditation and...
Well, my advice to tell you is that, you know, that you always keep in mind, but I don't care what you do.
Nope.
First of all, this is for everybody else. So I'm going to take you off the screen for a minute, but you're there listening.
Yep.
Nobody owns AA, so people can take control of it in any way that they want. It's a very interesting thing. And in fact, a cult actually invented a thing called NA and made it... And SA, and they made a million different groups under the same principles, and nobody owns that except they control it, and that's Scientology. But besides that, now there could be any affiliated groups using the principles. So
yeah,
and when people ask me to meditate, I explain to them, I'm like, man, my life is a fucking meditation. You don't even have a clue. And what it takes me to be so screwed on. But anyway, what I did was I took every fucking thing that made sense, every piece of wisdom, every story, every piece of advice, and I took that all to heart from my men's groups.
Yeah.
And then I set out to do what I wanted to do. So for each person, you know, they're going to tell you in the main 12 step, they're going to tell you that all they know is what works for the 5%.
That's right.
They don't know any other way that works, but they do know that if you absolutely follow it, that in theory, we know at least 5% of the people get it and got it until the day they die. No matter how hard or whatever came up, somebody died or they got rich or they got poor, that they got it.
Yeah.
And they're grateful. So far be it from me to ever tell anybody how to do it. And it's never over till it's over.
That's right. And for me, you know, like, I tried it every possible way, and the last thing I wanted to do was sit in a church basement drinking shitty coffee on a Friday evening, you know, or whenever. But, you know, like you said, whatever works, you know?
Well, it's kind of important to tell people about how fucking miserable that would lead you to go to a church basement, drink a shitty coffee.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was just...
What broke your back?
Well, basically the Miami-Dade Police Force.
Wait a second. A quick question, okay? So you're saying the Miami police were stronger than heroin in this case?
Basically, someone like me doesn't do well in jail. My aesthetic doesn't work with the inside aesthetic. it just doesn't, it's not the same. And
I always tell these motherfuckers, the day you put me in jail is the day I raise an army. So think about that. You put me in prison and you have a fucking army. In minutes.
Yeah.
So you better put me in solitary, because you will have a fucking army.
Basically, for me, like, if I didn't change my way of life, for me, not for anybody else, I would never tell anybody what to do, like you just said, too, is that I would have either been dead in an institution or, like, you know.
Jail's institution or death.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so... For me, you know, like, there's a bunch of different things, but one of them was, you know, my mom, I'm going to zoom into me now. My mom was like, you know, my mom came up to visit me one time at my house in Laurel Canyon, hanging off a cliff and above Johnny Depp's house and just, you know, up in Lookout Mountain and all that. All that stuff. And she came up there and she said, because I told my sister that I need to go to Mexico and get clonidine and phenobarbital. I need to sneak across the border and get it and then bring it back and detox.
Yeah.
And then she was like, holy cow, what are you, you're really going to do that? I go, yeah, I'm going to detox myself just like a rehab. And I'm going to be dead if I don't do this right now.
Yeah.
And she was like, holy shit. But I'm like, don't tell anybody. And so immediately my mom shows up. And my mom's like, not all touchy-feely. She's more, these days, we're a lot tighter, but she was not that type of person. She goes, you know, I used to love Janis Joplin so much, and that just killed me when she died and she threw that all away. And she's like, dude, you've just got to fight this with everything you've got in your life inside you. And that's all she said. She's like, she was like, everybody in the world swore that you were going to fail, and you showed everybody in the world that they don't know what they're talking about since you were very young.
Right.
She's like, that's an amazing quality just to have. So, but just the look, I'm going to tell you, just the look in her eye of a profound sadness.
Yeah.
Of that, those two concepts in an equal balance at that moment. We're hanging on two sides of the scale. She said, one of these things was that you were stronger than the whole world, and the other one is that you've been defeated by yourself. And they're in equal balance at this moment, and it could go either way. But she didn't break it down. But by her words, she just said that. So that was one of the things, too. Just that set me on a different path of just like, well, then I have to succeed not to please my mom, but just to fuck the world.
Yeah.
And it didn't matter that Dr. Drew told me right to my face that there was one segment, a portion of my mind that was my willpower, and one that was... the area where my brain that really enjoyed narcotics, see, and those two never connected. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's why he said, that's why we fail. And that's why I said, fuck you, Dr. Drew.
Yeah, I know a bunch of people. I mean, you know, this area, it's like all the same kind of characters, roaming, you know. And that's so funny, but Dr. Drew, I'm definitely a satisfied sort of customer, and it's interesting because both of us probably, I can't speak for you, but I'm just, and I don't want to tell your story, it's your story to tell, but like, you know, we both did things that we don't do anymore. And, you know, because it sort of became, for me, anti-productive. I didn't do anything, you know? But, like...
I did a lot of stuff, though. See, so, I mean...
See, that's where it gets tricky.
People don't understand. I was only strung out for, like, just a few number of years, but I was also... My craziness level, though, started before that, even.
Yeah.
And my manic thing, I never had a problem chasing my mania. So that is what happened in my mid-20s. And the drugs, and then after that, the alcohol, were all about self-medicating and also just, like, going for it all the way.
Yeah.
So, see, when I'd be in a manic phase, like, talking with God and all that stuff, and kicking down all the truths from inside me that I know to be real. I mean, I could just draw them for you, and they're absolute ancient truths that just come out inside you. And I'm telling you right here that the man who invented the flute did not take flute lessons. So you don't have to, you know, it's like this stuff is real. It's the real deal. So I had no problems if everybody thought I was an idiot, and I was a shaman from a time-traveling Inca god. You see what I'm saying? Playing mm-hmm. sitar in my studio. I didn't give a fuck what they thought. So, you know, fast forward with my family and all my responsibilities, various, not only Wolfgang, but Herman or whatever, you know, I have to just like chill the fuck out because I would be dead even on that level, even if I wasn't drinking. Because...
Yeah, well, there's another kind of death that's more internal death. Like, for me at least, it was like I don't hate to say it, but it was more like a spiritual death, you know?
Speaking of spiritual death, I'm going to die if I don't go to the bathroom, so now everybody dig this song.
Yeah.
watching Dead TV with me and Gregg. How about that? Take a look at this. How about... How do I do that? Oh, yeah, that. How about that? Took a second. So how you doing, man? Thank you for hanging out. What time is it in L.A. on the West Coast? It's 9 hours back.
3:38 a.m.
Wow, I can't believe that you're staying up for this crap.
I'm actually, well, we haven't talked in a while, but also I'm usually up till at least 5 anyway.
What are you doing, working at Dunkin' Donuts on the night shift?
I'm working at Tang's Donuts on actually, it's closed now. It's closed for good. No, I just work on, I'm doing a, this week, you know, WFMU in New York City?
Sure.
Or in Hoboken or whatever. I'm doing a guest radio show on their station called Rock and Soul Ichiban, which is like 60s garage, soul, R&B, all that good stuff. And that's Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern time. So I've been working on, you know, picking out the 45s and all that kind of stuff. I've been playing only 45s now.
Derek C. sometimes will
have
one pressed up when he doesn't have the actual song on a 45 because he only does 45s.
So he'll do that.
He'll do a test pressing. They used to have that shop right next to the three club where the guy had a lacquer and did $25 dub plates. He had one of the A&M cutters. It used to be right. I don't know where he's at now. I can't remember what he's called, but if you ask around, if you cross the street past Tushinaya Bowl.
Yes, I know where it is.
And you keep, there's that building on the corner and you keep walking. He was like the last, say like there's four little storefronts. He's the last one. And if you look, he had so much business, he might still be there. But I mean, this has been years, but.
Yeah, but do you know anybody else that would do that? Like cut a cheap one-off?
Yeah, they're just called dub plates. They're 25. They're usually like 25. My guy's so busy.
I just need like, what we were going to try and...
My guy's so busy. I wouldn't even ask him.
There's a couple DJs here that are like really into vinyl. And we were going to do 45s, two songs on each side.
I fucking hate them. I hate 45s. So can we move the conversation along quickly?
Really?
Well,
you like 10 inches, I know. And that's what she said. Oh!
Yeah. But I think there's only like 15 stores or something that sell 45, so it's like, what's the point?
Yeah, well.
Or like for six stations that'll even play them.
For me, like, carrying them around as so many DJs, you know, with 45s, it's like much easier than like carrying around LPs.
Yeah.
Not only weight, but then searching through the grooves to try and find your one song, you know.
But I carry around hundreds of kilos of those things. You know, I put them in a big roller. I bought a roller on Sunset the last time I was there on Hollywood Boulevard at one of those little Lebanese guys, you know, that's selling suitcases or whatever. I paid like $65 for it, and I just filled it up with records, you know.
Yeah.
So I just put my fry tags in there with my backpack. I find that a backpack, if you get like an Eastman backpack that has a slot for your computer, you can actually hold twice as many records almost as a fry tag bag in one of those Eastman backpacks that cost $100. So,
right.
So you can hold twice as many as your DJ bag.
Yeah, well, I just use this freaking box that's like you could bring it on the airplane, you know, because I've been doing these things.
But you can bring your backpack too. See, and if you're tricky, it depends what airline, you can actually carry something in your hands and they won't notice that you're wearing a backpack.
But is the backpack have your computer or does it actually have records?
I don't use my computer. I'm part of the fucking future, baby. I got a fucking iPhone 6.
Okay.
I use my computer for Pro Tools, and I use my other computer that's my wife's for Photoshop, because my laptop's on the fritz. I have a stack of laptops. You can't see me, but I have a stack of laptops this big of Apple's. It's just like, well, I burned through those fuckers. It's like crazy.
I do too. I've got four, but not as many as you. But they're I just crazy. Had to fix the hard drive.
There's one with a broken screen that, you know, was in the back of the tour bus and somebody fucking stepped on it or something.
Okay. But if that happened to me.
If I ever fixed that one, the black one, that one, the operating system, for some reason, and the Wi-Fi, both Ricky and I had that model, and I swear to God that we went on tour everywhere in the United States, and we would just search for a Wi-Fi connection, and it would let us into anybody's Wi-Fi anywhere. I don't know why. Like, would it ask you for the password for the network? You just don't even press anything. You just press okay, and you're just on their network immediately.
By the way, speaking of Katie, she took this really nice picture of us. I don't know if you can see this, but I put it up, and she posted it. It was kind of sweet to remember.
Huh.
You know, but it was...
I can't remember what her blog is called. I wonder, let's see, it's like, is it Love, well, Love Katie at...
Love this Katie? Was on her Instagram, you know, she had posted it, and I was like, oh, that's so great.
I wonder if I can do this, go to Google. So let's see. Katie Lane, maybe. Tumblr, maybe, or...
Wait, I got something to show you. While you're doing that, I know you...
Well, I think I just found her, so let me add another screenshot, and we'll look at my wife's pictures for a minute while you're looking for whatever you're doing.
I'm just pulling out some stuff that you hate.
1 second. Let me see, full screen. Okay, I'm gonna just scroll through my wife's pictures. The top one, and I'll try to tell you what they are. The top one looks like me and Ryan and Wolfgang walking through a cemetery in the snow, and Ryan, or me, looks like me holding Wolfgang. It's a German cemetery.
Right.
There's Ryan Van Crete in Berlin, if you're looking at the screen, smoking. My wife's quite good at photographs.
Yes, she really is.
Do you know that I'm going to release a book on my label? She's going on tour of America, and she's going to finish up the BGM book or whatever it's going to be. But this is just going down the street in the snow we had this year, global warming. There's little Shushu with his dinosaur cap. This is Will Carruthers from Space and 3 Spectrum.
Yeah.
Spiritualized. That's Will in my studio. This is from a dinner we just had. There's a picture of the drum skins for BGM, and here's the drum skin, the front skin for the Tess Parks group.
Oh, I love her. That was really great that you guys worked together. I've known her since she was really she's a Cat Power fan. She used to just show up at shows, and I put her on the list.
Yeah, she's all right.
Super cool. Love her.
Yeah, and I love working with her, and I'll tell you why in a minute.
Okay.
That was an ugly picture of me, but she likes it. This is a beautiful picture. Katie gets this Impossible Project Polaroid film that's in a circle shape. So that's Wolfgang and Ryan on the swings. Ryan is such a good uncle to my kid, one of my kids. There's Katie and Ryan dressed up in the new Brian Jonestown Japanese version, or... I guess one of these is the American version, one is the Japanese version. This is the paper in Berlin of when David Bowie died. And I asked her to buy two copies so I can frame it for my studio of the Berlin Morgenpost. Because to me it was like, how cool is that? Like if you have that hanging, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Other people from like my parents' generation would save, even in their garage, the one from when Kennedy died, or when they walked on the moon, and for me it was David Bowie dying. This looks like me at Spiller's Records, the oldest record shop in the world, and it's in Wales. And there's Tom Jones. This is some Christian in Wales has a giant cross on their house. This is a lake, me and Baby at the farm out here up north in Berlin, and me and Baby walking down a road on the lake, and there's us by the dock at the farm. And there's another picture of the dock. And these are the horses. I like that picture. This is one of the bartenders at 8mm, it looks like. And God, I'm sure this blog just goes on and on.
Yeah.
But they can look at it on their own time. I found it by going it's Miss Katie at Tumblr. .com. And she's got a website and all that stuff. But there, we've given Katie a plug. And like I said, there's some good stuff in there. That wasn't a waste of time.
Never. No. Your show always kind of talks about all sorts of stuff.
Yeah, we mix it up. So let me mix it back up to Skype current call. There we go. Yeah. That's you. And then looking up here, let me see if this one. There's me and you together. Amazing how that works. So I do have these other guys in the studio here, but I say at 1 o'clock we'll switch the program to the next phase. But
That's cool because I got to
roughly.
Do I've been looking at these fucking things. I'm doing like this radio thing this week, but I the thing that you did that the pharmacy radio show that I do for Dangerous Minds. I constantly keep buying records. I just found this one. This is a weird one. It's like a suicide 45, but it's die cut like a saw blade.
That's beautiful. I like when people do weird shit.
Weird, right?
Yeah, that's good.
And then, the basics, like this really great fall 45 that's got one of my favorite songs, Deadbeat Descendant.
Yeah, that's a great song. We should listen to that song.
This Alice Dona, great French organ freak out. First Stranglers 45. This is a German classic.
Yeah, you know what? Let me see if I can grab this and this other one. We'll see if it works, and if it doesn't, we'll play the natural one. Going backwards. You know, what I wanted to say is, like, one of the perks of me doing so well with my label and with all this stuff, right, as you're showing all these goodies off, is, you know, it's kind of funny, like, we're like this underground band and nobody knows how popular we are. Like, our shows sell out. So you can't gauge it like, oh, well, they just sold out the Fox Theater in Oakland or whatever. You can't really tell how big we are because we could have done it twice, but we just didn't. And like this time, right, we go to San Francisco, we're doing the Independent, you know.
Well, still, the freaking selling out the...
Roundhouse?
The Wiltern is... not a small feat. It is like, it's pretty impressive. Like,
with no radio or anything.
Yeah, it's fucking good, man. For in this day and age, forget it. There are bands that are biggish that can do nights at the Fonda, maybe.
Yeah. You know? Well, also, people don't understand that all these bands that have deals and stuff or connections and distributors and there's money to be made, that they grab 500 tickets and those are comps. See, I understand the business. We don't do that.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a reason. I mean, see, to me, the way you do it is the way that everyone should do it, but they don't.
I tried to tell everybody, man. I try and tell them on this show, I go, look, what you want to do is you want to form a collective and you want to figure out where you're going to rehearse. And that can start in your living room without a collective. And you could use a cheap acoustic guitars and a suitcase with a maraca, two maracas, as that'll be your kick drum and your snare going boom, tsk, boom, boom, tsk. you get your girl or whatever to sing, and you start practicing like that. Then you figure out how to get a rehearsal space with some people, and then you share gear. And then you go to a Chinese restaurant, if you're in California, say, that's got a big other room and a liquor license, and you go, look, man, you guys close at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, basically. On a Thursday night, what we want to do is we want to have this club, and we want to set up a DJ table, and this isn't like gangbangers coming. These are just some people that want to come. You could do it at a Mexican restaurant. Like I was telling them to do it at the Globe for so fucking long. I was telling Tammy, let's do it. But now people do it. You know, the Globe and there.
Yeah, Los Globos, right up the street.
I was telling everybody to do that there forever. But anyways, you pick one of these places, and they got the and you say, you keep the liquor, and you charge like $3 to get in or whatever. And you go bananas, right? And every now and then you start having one band play for like 30 minutes. You don't want 3 bands. This is just like something added on the cherry. And you figure it out. If they don't have a turntable, you can hire a DJ that comes to a party, and when he gets there, like he charges like $150 for it. You know, you find somebody that has turntables. Now it's hard to do because everybody has their CD DJ, but you can actually call SIR any of these places and get your...
Actually, I have a place in LA, if you're here, that will bring the whole sound system with turntables for $320. Okay. And set it up and break it down.
Okay, so now we're talking that we need a place where you would have to have 100 people fit in this space or whatever. So now you might have to charge $7 to get in, or $5.
Yeah, well, the times are different. You know, $5 is fine. If you don't want $5,
but then... you make it cool. So the next thing that you do is you invite. This is even if you're in a band. What you're doing is you're providing the fucking best entertainment in town. Then what you want to do is you want to go to Kinko's Copies or whatever the fuck the copy shop is called. And you want to make business card size copies of this weird ass flyer. And you can want to call it the Night Train or whatever you want to call it. You want to think of like something that's really cool, like Dead Pete Descendants. Like, I used to just put Take Acid Now and come to this fucking freak out on next week, you know? I used to do that on all of our flyers. Take Acid Now, but come see Brian Jones to Masquer on Friday.
Yeah.
And then you just hand those cards out to every good-looking girl you see at the other shows. At the other nights, you just hand it to them. Just say, while you're casually out drinking at somebody else's party, you're handing out business cards. And just smile at them. But just give them to all the girls.
Right, because nobody wants to go to a place that's all dudes.
Man, if you get the pretty girls to come, even the lesbians will come.
Yep.
That's a scientific proven fact. Everybody will come.
Yep. Shit, I'm writing this down. I gotta take some of these notes.
And if you want, you can have it in your other pocket. You could write free entry in a red pen on it. Just for the certain honeys or whatever.
Right.
And tell them. And you could come in free. And you make it the coolest fucking thing in the world to be at. And you just start doing it. And if you're in the UK, you do it in the back of a pub. And you just start doing it. And then you call it Soundgasm or any of the names that I've used.
Yeah,
and then you just start doing this and you move it around. And you always call it the same thing. And then you go into, you talk to this other club that's not doing stuff all the time that, you know, they spin records on some night. And you pick a weird night and you do it there. And you say, we're having a bigger Soundgasm there. And then you pick 2 groups. You don't want 5 groups because it's annoying. And forget about it. It's fucking too much. You would rather play really cool music all night. So people could sit through 2 bands, man. You have 1 early band. So if the Doors are at 8 or 9, you got a 10 o'clock band. And then if you're in the UK, you got to worry about the trains.
Yeah.
So I would suggest having 1 band unless you have an earlier opening. So if it starts at 8... you got a 9 o'clock band, then so that's 1 hour of DJ. Then you've got an hour after that, and make the band set like 30 minutes, just like in the '60s. And then the next thing you got to do with your band, you got to remember this: is look, when you're doing the PA and all this system, you got to make everybody play at the level of the drum set. So you don't even use the PA to start with. You got to just have You just got to have somebody. You got to have the band start playing, and you hook up the vocal mic, and you go, "Look, you're too loud for me to hear the drums." So I'm just telling you right now, I'm not going to turn on this fucking PA until you understand what I'm saying. And then you go, bass, we want a little bit more low end from you. Guitar, stay right where you are and trust me. And then you go, okay, now I'm going to make these drums sound really good. I'm going to add some drums in there. And you guys all stay right where you're at because I'm adding the low end to the kick drum. So there's whoomp. And then you go, okay, now I'm going to take that guitar because you're listening to me and I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to pan it all the way to the opposite speaker of where you're standing. And then you put it in their monitors if there's monitors. And you go, you guys can hear everything, right? Okay. And you just leave it there and just say, the first time you guys turn up, I'm just turning off the whole sound system, even the vocals. And you guys could just leave and that'll be the end of your set. So we're just going to leave you right there. And then that's going to force the whole audience to move closer and closer, like when the Yardbirds and the Stones were playing at 30 watts. Because they want to be closer to that fucking feeling. And then the 30 minutes of the brevity of it is going to make them fucking flip out and want more of it. And you say, that's you guys did so good, man. I want to have you play again. Then you have a DJ play and you make it fun until they throw you out. And then you do it again. You just you create your own scene just like I did. And since he just told you in L.A. how you could rent a sound system, you go to the Masonic Temple and you just go, hey, man, we want to rent this place out from you. How much does it cost?
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. They're still doing that at places like Paris Space and HM157 where they're just having like these little throw a show, you know, or Nonplus Ultra. It's like a new venue that's just like in a space. You know, where you could actually go, hey, can we do the show and have DJs and they have turntables? I don't know if they would charge you to use the place, but it's something, you know? Well, I mean, it's easy to do, except people don't take that initiative. They think, oh, I could never do it. I could never put out a record. I could never do a show. I could never do it. It's like, it is in this day and age, it's a lot easier probably even, you know?
Yeah, well... I'm interested in doing stuff that's cool. So speaking of cool, let's see if this works. And if it doesn't work, then I'm going to just play the actual single version. So let's try this. Ready?
Yep.
Is pure hell. Enter at your peril. Take 5 dead big steps to a stroll. Act like you just got out of jail. You must be repellents. The dance great big descendants. Clang, gong, chant. Dead big descendants. Shout! Thank you.
you know, we had a crash right in the middle of that. Ugh. A crash. The show is fucking brilliant. Meanwhile, my mate Gregg is like tipped, fell off his chair. It was so fucking brilliant.
Yeah.
I wish everybody would tell everybody how great the show is. I accidentally fucked up that video. So next time, by adding another video in, I tried to grab another song. And this program just, I'm using a hack of an obsolete program and in a way that it was probably never intended to play. And I refused to use their new ones. So I just grabbed this one. So it just crashes periodically. But it's a small price to pay for such quality programming, you know?
Yeah.
This has been brilliant. I'm going to make this available on YouTube.
This one, yeah. I like when you do that.
Yeah. I put on some great ones, and YouTube just snipped them in the buns, which is such a shame because in some territories it's all groovy Tuesday. You know, obviously, because if I'm getting the music off of YouTube, but then they'll just block it for no reason whatsoever. They're like, oh, you played a video clip of Blue Jay Way or something, you know?
Yeah.
And then they wreck my whole film when I'm trying to educate people about music.
That happened to me when I did an interview with David Jay that I had played 2 or 3 Bauhaus songs in the show, and they blocked it, and I was like, well, I get why, but the artist gave me permission. They didn't care, you know? They were just like, whatever.
You know, there's this whole thing about Dr. Luke and Keisha.
Yeah.
You're up on that, right?
Yep.
And another woman artist said, we need to band together and fucking put it into this railroading and locking this woman out of her ability to make an income or anything after she's been raped and all this shit. And I said, I comment right on her Twitter. I go, well, you know, this all starts with the fucked up contract that you don't read, don't you?
Yeah. And what did they say? Nothing?
It's like anybody else under any circumstance also, right, would go, this motherfucker just raped me, would call the police, right, if it was wrong.
Yeah.
Unless they were worried about getting kicked out of the party and doing more drugs and that record contract and being a star. See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is like people need to take every allegation of rape seriously. So I agree with that.
Agreed.
And it needs to be looked into by professionals and listened to, even if it's historical.
In New York City, there's a group of professionals that investigate special crimes of this sort.
Yeah.
They're called the Special Victims Unit.
Yeah, but what the judge said in the case is like, oh, the contract is standard. She had Mark Gregarious as her lawyer, and he couldn't bust that contract against Sony. And I'm like, every contract could be busted. What is going on behind the scenes here?
Obviously there's something going on that we don't.
But you know what I would do immediately if I was her? I would be like, fucking record a record and go sue me. I don't give a shit. I would start releasing shit online and just go check this out, try and block it. Here I am dropping the bombs. Fuck you. Fuck you. Yeah. And I'm going to play a show with my new music that's all over the internet. Here's a video of me blasting it on YouTube. And I want everybody who believes me, who's against fucking being raped and held prisoner, to come and support it. And here's this new t-shirt I made. But, you know, she sold away the rights to everything because they created her.
So yeah, that's 90% of them.
I know. It's a 360 deal. But she should expose how horrible the whole system is, but all these fucking people, it doesn't matter. She was in high school. If somebody says that to me, I've been fucking against the fucking system since I was in fucking junior high school or before. Fuck you. You don't know what you're talking about. You've got a fucking computer in your fucking pocket. You can look up all this information about every fucking bad deal in the history of these fucking pigs. raping people and fucking using your music. Reporting rape, bullshit, man. A six-year-old child should be able to fucking report a rape. The problem is fucking society. What are they teaching these fucking idiot kids? Well, look how she fucking, the persona of how she fucking acts in her videos is not fucking genius. I'm not saying she deserved anything, but what I'm saying is, like, you should be fucking telling fucking your kids to go, dude, don't touch me, and no means no.
Yeah.
Especially around Catholic priests.
Or beyond that.
Or anybody.
How about teaching boys, don't rape? That's bad. You know what?
What are you going to fucking do? Because we got society, you teach people, there's all different types of things. What we do is we try the best that we can do. But all this weird culture where people disrespect everything, even dolphins on the beach, it doesn't matter. They fucking, people rape the environment, they rape each other, they rape all this stuff. But what I'm saying is basically that, first of all, these contracts are bad. And people want it so bad that they go, this is my only chance. And if they got any skills, then they should fucking know that there'll be other chances. Or they should be tricky like me and go, well, I'll do a deal with you for one record. And if that goes good, then let's do another record. Show me how good you are. Otherwise, fuck off.
Exactly. Exactly right. I mean, again, these are things...
But all women all women need to stand up, especially in this situation. She should stand up, and everybody who believes her and believes in what I'm saying should support her in that way, not fucking... Obviously, the system has let her down. So to pursue, she has the biggest lawyer in the world. They got fucking OJ and Michael Jackson off for raping a kid. If that guy can't do it, he is so dialed in, you don't even know. You know, and it's Mark fucking Gregarious. If that guy can't do it, it's a fucking insider track. It's Sony going, okay, well, Sony Universal, we own everything, including Keisha's ass in this situation. Mm-hmm. So she needs to take the fucking system down and be the poison pill. And fuck her career. She should be a hero and known for doing it.
Yeah, I agree.
She should spill every single fucking bean. And go, he drugged me. Yeah, we were incredibly close recording. It was a very emotional time. My dreams were coming true and he took advantage of that. And that isn't right because he was the adult in this situation. Yeah. And he used that... intimacy as a wedge, and then he used it as a weapon against me, and because of that, payback is a bitch and fuck my career, because I'm about to show you what I'm made of. First, I'm going to fix this problem. See, it's not how you step in shit, it's how you get it off your shoe.
That's exactly right,
because everybody steps in shit to various degrees.
That's exactly right. It's kind of like, it's how you walk through it, you know? It's like, can you get through it? What happens? How do you get through it, you know?
But, you know, I have zero respect for that person to begin with, her or him. But I'll tell you what, this is a wonderful opportunity for her to gain a lot of respect in a lot of ways. And it's more than just speaking up about some horrible incident. Because she could fucking take the system down. Because this shit happens every day. It happens in Hollywood to every one of these fucking blonde actresses. They just line them up. It's called the casting couch. They just fucking do this. They're like, do you want to work or not? They do it to fucking everybody. These fat, hairy pigs. They fucking do it to everybody. They go, do you want to work? When I look at old pictures of these actresses, Doris Day or whoever, I'm like, wonder who she fucked.
Right.
Every single one of them.
Crazy.
And so people got to take that shit down all the way. And one of the ways you could take it down, I guess, is having women in positions of power across the board. But then, you never heard of a lesbian gym coach? Happens there too.
Yeah.
It's just people.
The world is just insane. Let's just see if we can agree on that.
That bombshell.
Are you going to switch to the studio? Because I think I'm going to shut it down for the eve.
Yeah, I'm gonna switch. I'm gonna go for it. Everybody, I'm gonna reboot the system.
Yeah.
Thanks, Greg.
It was wonderful. Hey, thanks, man. It's always good talking to you, and we'll talk more soon.
Well, we wish the best for her, but I'm rooting for real justice, which would be to upset the apple cart, because this is not a unique situation. I don't care what that fucking Dr. Luke, Dr. Puke said. This is not a unique situation. It can be used as education. When a situation happens like this, when you look at something even as awful as the Holocaust, and you go, fuck, what? How can something positive come from something that's so horrible? It has to be an example to humanity of what humans are capable and how atrocious they can be, how fucked up everything is. Or it's nothing. You know, it's nothing. It's just like a statistic. You have to remember that. So you got to use every single situation like this as your opportunity. And on that thought, I'll be back in 1 minute with Alex Lipinski.